My name is Neil Richards, and I'm going to talk to you today about building a community of excellence and why it's important to a strong data culture. Everything I'm going to talk about is here in this title slide. So first of all, I'm going to talk about what data culture means, get some ideas of what that kind of means, and go on from there. And then I'm going to talk about different types of community, focusing on sort of internal data communities within your organization, and talk a little bit about external communities as well. And third thing I'm going to talk about is this guy, and that's me. Don't worry, I'm not going to talk about me for very long, but just to sort of give an introduction about myself. So this is me. I'm really kind of showing you this because this is what I would look like if I hadn't been in 9 weeks of lockdown. I love to get out and about, and I love to talk about data and talk about all the kind of things that I love to do. It also looks like I'm here at Tableau Conference, stroking a large invisible dog. I'm not quite sure what I was actually doing there, but I was obviously having a bit of fun. So quite often when I get to talk, I love to talk about design. Weird or interesting ways you can design your data. This is a project I decided to emulate album and turn that into a data visualization. And I like to push the boundaries. This when I decided to look at Sesame Street data and how to visualize that, I could only think of one way, and this was my sort of kind of unique way of doing that. But it's important to sort of follow the best practices as well. I'm probably equally proud of this visualization, which is a very simple line chart. Of course, it's about me. I had to be sort of fairly unique. And this is going to be featured in a book about data visualization next year. So I'm really pleased about that one as well. So let's start about talking about data. And if I were there with you today in Tbilisi and maybe a bit more interactive, I would ask you a question. And I would say, who here works in a data company? And I would maybe expect some of you to have a think about it, and I would expect most hands to go up, and I would then sort of show this slide, which says every company is a data company. If data is at all used or is at all important in your company, then you really consider yourself as a data company, whether that's data about your products, your customers, your clients, your web views, anything like that. And so, because we think of every company really as a data company, every organization needs to be data-driven. It might be very much the buzzword, but it's been often stated that if you consider yourself a data-driven company, that's how that you can start to make these decisions based on data to drive your organization forward. So my talk's going to be about how you can underpin a data culture. Data culture is really what we might think of when we talk about driving forward to a data-driven company. So let's start about thinking, actually, what is culture? Now, you might first think, well, culture, that's things like opera or fine arts or philosophy, something like that. But that's not really what culture means. Culture means growth. So you think of maybe horticulture or agriculture or the term cultivating. All these things come from the term meaning growth. Now, this definition is from, essentially from a site called Simple Wikipedia, which is great. It's great for mathematicians like me to be able to explain things simply. And it says culture is a word for the way of life of groups of people and something that's passed on to the next generation by learning. It goes on to say that that's seen in things like writing, religion, music, clothes, etc. But really it's talking about a way of life, which is integrated knowledge, habits, behavior, all things which have been passed on through the generations. And so that makes it easy to think of, to introduce another passion of mine, which is the great apes. We talk about great ape culture. And here's an orangutan in Nyerere Mentin. It's photos by Gert Schuster. And he photographed this orangutan who'd learned tool use, how to spear fish for hunting, which is pretty amazing, really, in great ape thinking and great ape culture. So that is a learned behavior which has been passed on through generations in this particular site of how to get a more interesting diet, how to learn how to hunt fish. Now, nobody thinks of great ape culture and thinks of a great ape at the ballet or the opera or something like that. So that the way of thinking of it as a learned way of life makes it easier to understand maybe what data culture is. So we combine those things. Here's a definition of data culture, which are like the collective behaviors and beliefs of people who value, practice, and encourage the use of data to improve decision-making. So that's why you want a data culture in your organization. You want to be able to improve your decision-making by using data, and you want it to be a way of life. So let's just highlight some of that, the people who value, practice, and encourage the use of data. And this, to me, that's where the community side of things come in. It's people who drive culture, and it's the data culture that drives the data-driven organization. All right, so here's a slide all about what you might consider the five elements that are vital to data culture. I won't read out all the text there, but you can see what that says. This was from some research from Tableau Software. Tableau had over 1,000 clients. I think they researched them, and they came up with these five pillars sort of based on feedback from their clients as to what a data culture does or what it means. And a data culture, it fosters trust, it develops talent, it seeks commitment and supports sharing, and ultimately it can involve, or it needs to involve sometimes, a change in mindset. This isn't particularly a linear to-do list. It's not a matter of you sort of go through this from left to right. They're all sort of interconnected. They might depend on each other many ways. They foundational changes.
And
these need to happen at every level of your organization. It can take quite a bit of effort and practice. So I mentioned that a data community, and that's kind of what I want to talk about, can really help drive this data culture. And most of what I'm talking about are internal data communities, so your data community in your organization. So let's start with these five pillars again. I'm going to cheat a little bit and move them around. Now, I did say it's not a linear process, but I want to move them around and talk about them in this order because there are some which are more sort of obviously community driven and others where the growth is a little bit more organic. So we'll start by developing talent. Now, how can you develop talent in your organization? I pulled out a few examples here, but obviously there are so many ways that you might want to do this. And this is kind of fundamental to growing a data community. Training, now you can do training in many ways. You can have classroom sessions, you can have webinars, and you perhaps will be doing that a little more in these times. Both of these might be sort of focused on the technical elements of data, what you might have in your organization. So whether it's Power BI or Tableau for visualization analysis, or whether it's Snowflake or Dremio or Alteryx, anything like that, any data tools that you have, obviously you would start with this kind of training. But it's important to have workshops as well. Not all of your training is going to be on the technical. Not all of your training is going to be on the how to do X in this piece of software. So you might there be focusing on theory or best practices, that kind of thing, or maybe sort of, well, I don't really know why I'm telling you all the different workshops you can have. There's a great track of workshops tomorrow. So you've got design and sketching and all that kind of thing. And all these things add to the development of talent. And I put rewards as well. If it's important, if you can, to be able to reward your participants. It's not always very easy. It depends if you have executive buy-in in many ways. If you do, then your rewards might be that you allow your participants to undergo certification, which can cost a bit, or to go to industry conferences. If not, you know, you might have to be a bit more creative. We might be able to reward with fun swag and things like that, or maybe a book or even just sort of email signature, which allows people in your internal community to be recognized as somebody who's reached a certain level. Now, the community needs to support sharing. Now, this is really important. Where I work, we have 300 or so analysts, but they're across different countries, they're across three different continents, all within different teams. So we have a lot of skill and talent, but they don't necessarily initially communicate with each other. So if you can embody the whole, the skills of the whole of your community, you're going to get so much better than the sum of the parts. So some examples that you might have here, newsletters. A newsletter, it might sound sort of old school, but it's a great way of sharing and communicating just exactly what's going on. What new training is available? What new resources have we found? What great work has been done by this team that you might not otherwise know about? So if you can celebrate success, share anything that allows all of your internal community to know what's going on, that's a really important feature. Intranet, portals, forums, a central internet page might be really sort of, you want somewhere that's the central focus where people can find out what's going on, where the people who are supporting the community are putting things on, or so putting their training or events on, and just somewhere to go, somewhere to find out what's happening. I mentioned forums as well. If you can have a sort of, we use Discourse and My Employer, which is a little bit like sort of Stack Overflow. But if you have the opportunity for people to ask each other questions and respond to each other, rather than just sort of having to go to the trainers each time, you can really build and foster that community as well. And I put chat and messaging. It might seem quite obvious, but especially if teams are disparate, there are different ways that people chat and message. They might have a sort of private group here, which means that they're not talking to anyone else. So if you can get something like that that's global and that allows everybody to talk to each other in a structured way, that can link into your intranet and your newsletters and things like that. I've talked about fostering trust next. I could potentially put this in other parts too, but I've put shared events. Once your community sort of builds up a bit, it's great to be able to host events. If your event, it might be local, so you might sort of get everyone together to discuss, have a kind of lunch and learn, or a user group, that kind of thing. Or you may even be able to expand pretty much company-wide. Have a half day or a day, have presentations, have people talk, have people share. And again, just to really build confidence in the community by passing to each other what kind of things that people are doing with data. And ultimately, this really sort of leads to confidence and people feeling empowered. And the slide I showed earlier, it mentioned trust. And the trust is two ways. The trust is in your employees, so that if your community has developed that talent and has really sort of started to engage, then we trust them. If we give them the right data, we trust that what they come up with is going to be the right decision and is going to help lead to a data-driven success. And the trust is also in the data itself. So if you can support your community with great data governance, if you look after that data, if you make sure that the right people can access the right data and that it's the right data to be using, that also leads on to that confidence and that empowerment, which all fosters the trust. So the reason I moved the elements around a little bit, as I mentioned, is not because it's a linear process, but some of these elements towards the bottom, they might feel like they need more executive buy-in. If you have that, that's great, but if not, then we're also sort of talking about how all this builds from the bottom up from within your community. So I mentioned first external community projects. If your community is really engaged and really wants to take part in things to improve their learning, you can start to look outside. You can look at makeover projects such as Tableau's Makeover Monday, or you can look at social good projects, all the different kind of hackathon data sets which are sometimes available. And you can bring them into your community. You can run workshops. You can start to take people outside of well, not so much outside of their comfort zone, but allow them to expand their horizons by looking at data which isn't the data that they see every day. And when we talk about being able to change mindset, this can be where your community is empowered to lead conversations with stakeholders. It could be that your stakeholders are quite often your senior executives anyway, people who've had things done the same way, maybe not in a great data-driven way that just says, just show me the tables, that's all I want, you know, show me something in Excel, I just want to print it off. You can start to, with the knowledge that you have and the talent, you can start to lead those conversations and say, well, right, we can give you that, but maybe I can show you something that's better analysis, that's going to help you see and understand the data a little bit better. So you can change the mindset, make it more data-driven, and you can change that from the ground up. And so with all these above elements in place, this really is what helps you to get commitment to a data culture. Another thing I mentioned there, apart from build from the ground up, is to develop champions. So maybe if you've got people who are embracing all five of these things, you can look internally within your community to think, who are my champions? Who can sort of start to do this job for me? So a little bit more about analytics champions. So maybe you have somebody who's worked hard and then becomes a champion. I guess some of you know who this guy is, Mr. Andy Murray. Wimbledon champion once, twice. So anyway, if you can identify traits in the community of people who've engaged most fully, maybe these are the people who've completed the training modules. They've passed a little test which says I've now reached this level. These might be people who have gone on to lead these internal workshops or lead user groups in their location and lead meetings in their teams. They might be involved in peer review, that kind of thing, and again to lead and help the perhaps more junior members in their team. So once you have analytic champions, data champions, that can really help you. The ideal situation is maybe these are the people who can then do the job for you. They then become the trainers and the community drivers and people who lead as well. So again, this follows the data culture of the learned behavior and sort of, if not generation after generation, you know, intake after intake or exec after exec, who can really sort of drive that culture for you. So I've spoken mostly about internal data communities. So about external data communities, you're probably a little bit more familiar with this because if you've all taken out time away from your working day today to attend this great lineup, you probably don't need so much introduction to this. And I started thinking, well, what are the different types of external data communities? And I thought, well, you've got the base around conferences and podcasts and things like that. And then at the corner of my eye, I saw this, which is my work laptop. Now, that probably shows how much I get involved into external data communities, if you like. But really on here, you can see examples of pretty much everything. You can see conferences. You can see, in fact, Dataverse Tbilisi conferences from last year when I met up with Nuno Lally, and you can see stickers from magazines. You can see the Cafe magazine there. Social good causes, communities, things like Data Plus Women. There's community challenges on there. There's Workout Wednesday, which is another great sort of challenge to improve your skills externally. Storytelling with Data is a community which works on a number of levels with around books and blogs and a whole new community system itself. Podcasts, did I mention that? Positivist podcast is just one. So many different resources you have externally and the communities that build around them, and not to mention conferences. You can really, the possibilities are almost endless. And then right in the middle there, something I'm obliged to plug, the Data Visualization Society. I won't mention much about this. I had a little chat about it while we were getting ready for this talk. But as I say, we've got well over 10,000 members, possibly 15,000 now, I'm not sure. And you can just go to datavisualizationsociety.com and find out a bit more about it. But really, it's worldwide and it's industry-wide. So anyone who has a connection with or an interest in data visualization, they're welcome to sign up, see what's going on. What I'm showing here was a community project within that. We asked people to visualize the membership of the first year of the Data Visualization Society. So we've got some great entrants there in all sorts of different software platforms. So yes, do go and check that out if you're not aware of that already. And yeah, it's almost with a heavy heart I show this. And you think, when was the last time we could all get that close to each other? This is a photo from Tableau conference, I think probably 2018. Not just to show that, hey, aren't Tableau people wacky and friendly when they all get together, although that's very true and you have a great time. But I looked at this, and sometimes I look to see, where am I? Did I make this particular photo? And I did find myself, just there hiding behind a guy. But the thing that amused me about this was that I didn't realize until I put this in my presentation a couple of days ago, the person I'm standing next to, sometime after this photo, eventually became my boss, and we worked together. So you can make these connections externally and through shared commitments or shared ideas that we had. We were both really keen in sort of introducing communities, and in this case, Tableau community, but data and analytics community in general. And so later we got chatting and decided, wouldn't it be great to try and introduce this within my current workplace Groupon? And so, you know, you can have such great networking opportunities externally, which can then lead into how you work internally in your organization. Which kind of takes me on to my next slide. Not very high tech this, but I just wanted to say that there is an overlap between sort of internal and external community. The overlap is not huge, but the overlap is there. It's not huge because can you imagine if you were in a large company and everybody was like me? Everybody wanted to go to every talk. They wanted to learn anything it was to do with data. They wanted to engage in all these ways. Most people, you probably need to understand, they want to do well, they enjoy their job, but they don't necessarily want to take it further than that, and that's okay. The external community resources there, and you can, there's a lot of movement in between, there's give and take. So if you're trying to drive the internal community, if you're external facing, you can bring these resources in, you can show a lot of the great new tips, tricks, blogs, videos, community resources, bring them into your internal community. And it does go the other way. Maybe as you develop your champions, they will start to look a little bit more externally and maybe see what they want to share, what they want to post, and what they want to sort of find in between. So if you sort of accept that you have that kind of that kind of balance and overlap, and you'll have a little bit of a transfer of knowledge and engagement in between, that's when you've got a good balance going on. And finally, as we get towards the end, I don't really want to talk about COVID-19. It's kind of the elephant in the room, and it's so important right now. Every person globally is affected by COVID-19, and I hope that for everyone sort of watching and listening, you know, that effect hasn't been too personal for you. But in your organizations, it's bound to have had an effect. So every community is going to be dealing with this, every data community, internally, externally, and every organization. So does that render what I've said invalid, or does that say that we need to do things a little bit differently? Now the short answer is no, not really. But there are some important things to bear in mind. Your company right now might just have different priorities. It might be that prior to COVID-19, it was really expanding, pushing ahead, really sort of engaging in what you were doing with data. It might be now that we just have to slow down. We have to regroup. We have to focus on what we're doing. And so you may feel that sort of community developing is taking a bit of a backseat, but that's okay. So long as you keep those resources available, so long as you keep those resources up to date, and your community focuses perhaps more on support, whether it's pastoral support or whether it's a technical support, maybe people will be doing more than one job, if you like, or taking on different roles or technical abilities, you're offering support in that way. So your company might have different priorities, your speed of what you're doing might change, but otherwise it's still very valid. And if you're thinking of particular things to do, particular courses to run, particular events, it might not be the right time. You know, it might be that you want to do something that's happening very close to a difficult time for the company, and so you need to sort of consider that. The flip side is, it probably is the right time. There will be difficult days, but once you're working through COVID, we're all in very different situations now. So many people are working from home. So many people don't see people from day to day. I've only left the house to walk the dog in the last 8 or 9 weeks. So anything that happens online, or anything that happens to bring communities together, is something that's even better received now than it has been before, because we don't have these chats across desks and things like that. So it probably is the right time. And then you will find that opportunities and experiences online, they can be different, but they can be just as good, which you'll probably be pleased to hear. In fact, they can be, you can reach a wider audience. I was making last minute changes to my speech yesterday, but I still had the opportunity to stop and join online gatherings with community members from Australia and New Zealand, and then the opportunity to see a user group in Singapore and things like that. And there's no way that I could have done that prior to all these virtual events happening. So it needs a different mindset, and you guys here are really showing that, and we'll see a great success today. But it doesn't mean that things have to be any differently, or that things don't need to be done. And I'm just going to finish with one last slide. You don't need to look sort of too closely at this slide. This is a slide which I produced at work. And the story behind this slide is, last week we hosted a global internal analytics event for the very first time. It was postponed. It wasn't ideally the right time at first, but we found a good date for it. And this was to report back to the speakers and the attendees and say, this was, you know, here's the map. Our global reach went from India to the US, and we spanned our three continents. We had people all across the day, across the different timelines. We had people view on two different platforms. And here's the success. Our viewing figures were quite good. So this just sort of says, it is okay to still sort of carry on. You can get some almost bigger successes. And it's kind of important, if you're doing sort of any engagement or any events or something like that, or trying to drive your community, almost use data or data visualization analytics as your language. So if people, I mean, this isn't a sort of hugely pretty visualization, but if people who work with data, analyze data every day, want to know the results of something, then show it to them in a data-driven way. And all that just sort of builds up the language, the way of life of a data culture within your community. And in this particular case, we had great success, and we had feedback all the way from C team level. So it's another example of pushing up from the ground to develop your data community and sort of be able to show what kind of success you can have. So I want to say thank you very much. Thank you for listening. Thank you for.